stone. Born with laser precision. The 47th verse of the 4th chapter of John's Gospel, the Gospel of John. Chapter 4, verse number 47. The New Living Translation gives us the following. When he heard that Jesus had come from Judea of Galilee, he went and begged Jesus to come to Capernaum to heal his son, who was about to die. Repeat these words after me. When he heard that Jesus had come from Judea to Galilee, he went and begged Jesus to come to his house to heal his son, who was about to die. I want you to look at your neighbor, say neighbor, or neighbor. Faith that goes beyond desperation. Look across the room, say neighbor, or neighbor. Faith that goes beyond desperation. Wonderful God, in the name of Jesus, bless the people. Help the preacher. In Jesus' name, amen. Desperation, God bless you, I should you make me see the desperation. It is a loss of hope and surrender to despair. It is a state of hopelessness leading to rashness. Desperation is the moment when one finds themselves with their back up against the wall, surrounded by hopeless situations. Do I have any hopeless situations in the house today? Do I have anyone under the stress of surrender? Am I speaking to someone who has deemed their situation hopeless? Do I have anyone who is feeling hopeless in the atmosphere? Is there anyone out there on the web who is on the verge of surrendering to despair? Your nights are getting darker. It appears that your days are getting shorter. Stress and hopelessness has caused you to be inflicted with headaches that a sectoral migraine won't knock out. Desperation is a dangerous piece for us this morning, because desperation can cause one to make rash decisions. Desperation can cause one to think that they are down when they are really up. Desperation can cause one to think that they are alone when they are really surrounded by people who love and care for them. Desperation impacts our lives in many non-healthy ways. Desperation can cause one to look for love in all the wrong places. Desperation can cause one to say, I do, when they should really say, no way, I wish I had a witness here. Upper Rivermen, our selected portion of the sacred text is housed in the Gospel of John. Somebody say John. Our anonymous writer writes in the late 80s or 90s common era to those who have witnessed the rupture between the synagogue and the Jewish Christians who claim Jesus as their Messiah. The Gospel of John's theme is Jesus Christ, the divine Son of God. The writer wants men and women to believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and receive new life through his name. The scholar Ehrman teaches the reader that the Gospel of John would be perceived by an ancient reader as a biography of a religious leader. It is a mosaic narrative that portrays an individual's life within a chronological framework, focusing on his inspired teaching and miraculous deeds and leading up to his death and divine vindication. Somebody say the text. The text indicates that Jesus returns to the vicinity of Cana of Galilee, where he had changed water into wine. I must pause real quick and suggest that Jesus can change some stuff in our lives. Jesus can change our communities. Yes, Jesus can even change or adjust who we are. But I get even more excited when Jesus changes the stuff around me. You see, beloved, I learned the hard way. I learned the hard way that one cannot change another person. Only the Lord and that person can change themselves. So for some of you sitting here listening to me, wherever you are, stop running around trying to run everybody else's life. Maybe just start giving your life and issues the attention that it deserves. Somebody's in the text. The text indicates that was a royal official who scholars suggest worked for Herod Antipas, whose son was terminally ill. Somebody say terminally ill. The text indicates that our royal official read all of the tweets and the Facebook post about Jesus. The royal official heard that Jesus was in the vicinity. So out of desperation, somebody say desperation. Out of desperation, he went to locate Jesus. And the text indicates that upon locating Jesus, he begged Jesus to go down to Capernaum, to his house, and heal his terminally ill son. Can I pause again and ask how many people in here want Jesus to come to your house? Now the reason why I ask the question, because as an experienced pastor, but in other places, Brother Lamar, when I would go to a member's house, and I would go unexpectedly, they would run and they would hide the Jack Daniels. I wish I had some help in here. And so I was trying to figure out, if you want me to come over and visit you, why are you going hide the Jack Daniels? But if you want Jesus to come to your house, I just want to know, y'all gonna run and hide? I wish I had some help in here. Somebody say the text. The text indicates that Jesus told him and whoever else was listening that they were a sign and wonder-based belief. I repeat this after me. Sign and wonder-based believers. The text indicates that the royal official said to Jesus, whatever, I look, my son is dying. I'm desperate and I need you to come down to my house and do something quick for my child. The text indicates that Jesus directed the royal official to go home, for his child would live. Somebody say he would live. The text indicates that the royal official believed the word that Jesus spoke and started his route back home. The text then indicates that as the royal official was en route to his home, he was met by his slaves who advised him that his son was alive. The text then indicates that the royal official questioned his slaves as to what time his son recovered. The slave advised him that it was around 1 p.m. The text indicates that the royal official then knew that it was the time that Jesus told him to go home. The text indicates that as a result of this incident, the royal official's whole household became believers. Now my job is to ask where God is in the text, and my theological response is that God wants the believer to develop a faith that goes beyond desperation. Beloved, desperation takes us on the journey of immediate resolution. We momentary for resolve of our situation of need. Somebody say situation of need. This text forces the believer to evaluate the validity of your faith. Baby, faith-based wonders don't develop a faith beyond desperation. I argue that there is a battle going on between catching now. Life-living faith, somebody say life-living faith, versus desperation faith. You see, the question for the hearer today is, are we living faith, or is our faith generated out of situations of need? Y'all ready to get on the train? The first faith that we all have to acknowledge here is called crisis faith. Look at your neighbor, say neighbor. Oh, neighbor. Are you always in a crisis? Check it out. Beloved, we must acknowledge from the very outset that most believers carry in their purse or in their wallet crisis. Yes, yes. You see, as believers, we are guilty of possessing crisis faith. Somebody say crisis faith. You see, the royal official came to Jesus with crisis faith. Crisis faith is simply when the believer has a situation of need. You see, the only time faith is really needed by these believers is when there is a crisis. Somebody say crisis. The text says that the royal official's son was dying, Mr. Law. So therefore, that was a crisis. And, you know, I would suspect that you may have a crisis faith believers in your circle. You see, they are the ones who don't go to church, always too busy for service, always critical of the ministry of giving, always critical of how the church spends resources, always critical about the service you expend to the kingdom. Don't ever have a praise. But when there is a situation of need in their life, they're always on the phone asking you to pray for. I wish I had some help in here. They're always talking about how prayer changes. Beloved, crisis faith won't go beyond desperation. You see, there ain't nothing real about crisis faith. You see, the royal official did not even know who Jesus was. All he knew was that on the Facebook post, Jesus was a wonder-working magician. You see, I don't ever, you see, want to be accused of only going to God when I'm in crisis. And that's why maybe I take time during the week just to call God and say hello. Y'all want to know what I tell God? This is what I'm telling. I say, God, I got a lot going on right now, but I just called you to say hello. I don't want nothing. I just wanted to check on you today. I just wanted to see how you're feeling. God, I'm not asking for anything in particular. I just want you to know that I love you and I thank you for waking me up this morning. And do I have anybody in the house right now who you just call just to say, Lord, I just want to bless your name. Lord, I was just thinking about how good you are. And I call just to bless you for being so good. Lord, woke up this morning and everything was in order. And everybody was alive. In fact, I got on the phone. Going on crisis, y'all ready? You need a confident faith. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, or neighbor, you need a confident faith. I got to work out. You say, neighbor, or neighbor, know this. Look at the text. After Jesus and the royal official shared a few words, Jesus directs him to go home. Somebody say, he told him to go home. Now we must understand that home, our school teacher's home, is 20 miles away. The text leads us to believe that the royal official is on foot. Jesus directs his father to go home on foot, which is 20 miles away, without seeing any evidence of change. But the confident faith helps you to see what you don't see. You see, the royal official came looking for tangible evidence, but instead is directed to go home to what would appear to be empty-handed. Jesus understands that the Father came with Christ's faith, but he wanted him to leave with confident faith, which goes beyond desperation. Beloved, just that fast, you can transition from Christ's faith to confident faith. The text says that the royal official believed and departed. You see, confident faith will help you see what you don't see. Confident faith says, I don't know how and I don't know when, but I know that my God is able. Although you may not see faith, nor hear faith, nor feel faith, nor taste faith, nor smell faith, confident faith can move mighty mountains in your life. Confident faith can open up blind eyes. Confident faith can conquer hostile enemies. Confident faith will aid you in praising God in advance. Confident faith helps you to shout before the battle is over. Confident faith helps you to smile in the midst of strength. Confident faith helps you to stay calm in the midst of a storm. Confident faith helps you to know that God will take care of you. Confident faith tells you that Jesus is a battle that's in the time of a battle. And I wonder, do I have any confident faith believers in this place? Do I have anyone listening to me on the web that is ready to praise God in advance for your breakthrough? Because you have confident faith. Do I have anybody up in here that you're confident that you know that God will take care of you? Do I have anybody bold enough that you're going to give God a praise right now? Even though you had got to your breakthrough, I'm confident that God is working something out. I'm speaking it into the atmosphere right now. That whatever you're dealing with, I'm confident that God is creating something brand new for you. Anybody in here that you have confident? So, confident faith. Then you have confirmation faith. Y'all with me? Confirmation faith. Look at the text. The royal official. Augustus, the royal official, is met by members of his household who advise him that his son is alive. I wish I had some help here. You see, the royal official wanted to know the window of time that the recovery took place. The royal official's members told him 1 p.m. The royal official knew that was the time that Jesus spoke life into his life. Oh my God, beloved, confirmation faith is designed to encourage us and strengthen us for the next dimension of our journey. Oh, I wish I had some help in here. Hear me today, wherever you are. Yes, every round goes higher and higher. God understands that we need encouragement to strengthen us for the next level of God's design. Christ's faith won't cut it, y'all. Christ's faith won't go beyond desperation. Confirmation to further us along in the process of life. Confirmation faith is there to prove to us that God is who God says God is. And I'm a witness. I'm a living witness. I'm a bona fide witness every time. Every time. Every time I begin to feel sluggish. Every time I begin to question decisions that I make. And every time that I begin to juggle a mortgage payment, God will confirm in real time that God is with me every step of the way. And that God will make a way out of no way. Confirmation faith will speak to those of you in your trusting moments to confirm to you that your trust in God is not in vain. Can I tell you what the proverbial writer says? Proverbs chapter 3 and 5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not rely on your own insight. And do I have any believers that will, in spite of your friends turning their back on you, in spite of misunderstandings, in spite of trials and tribulations, in spite of afflictions and disease, that you will trust God now? Oh, why don't you be bold? Why don't you be daring and confirm to the enemy that is messing with you right now that I will trust in God? I'm going to trust God now. Tell that headache I'm trusting in God. Tell that cancer I'm trusting in God. Tell the enemy I'm going to trust in God. Now look at your neighbor, say, neighbor, oh neighbor, I'm trusting God now for what has not happened yet. That's the power of confirmation faith. You're going to trust God now even though you don't see it. You're going to trust God now even though the healing can't come. You're going to trust God now even though your tie hadn't been fixed. You won't trust God now, even though the check is not in the bank. Do I have anybody in here? I'm going to confirm right now that I'm going to trust. I'm going to trust. Not only am I going to trust, but I am going to obey. Wherever God wants me to go, I'm going to go, God. When it doesn't make sense, I'm going to go, God. Because I trust in love. Anybody in here, you've been on the road a long time, but you can say to the enemy, I'm not tired yet. Don't you understand that the enemy's trying to weigh you down? The enemy's trying to weigh you out. The enemy believed it was on the power of his witness. It was on the power of his testimony that everybody in his house believe Jesus as a rock in a weary land. Do you have contagious faith? Do you have a testimony in here that the Lord is alright? Do you have a testimony that the Lord made a way for you? Do you have a testimony that the Lord picked you up? Turn you around. Do you have a testimony that the Lord put food on your table? Do you have a testimony that put minutes on your phone? Do you have a testimony that the Lord put health in your body? Do you have a testimony that your mind is well? living girl of change.